Guten Morgen, guten Tag und guten Abend from historic Richmond Town, where Oktoberfest is taking place, and that means lots of food and drinks and music and tons of fun.
Remove hats. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic
for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I would now like to introduce Michelle Andolfo, who will be singing our national anthem.
I'm Eric Campione from the Staten Island Rotary Club. I want to thank all of our sponsors here tonight, in particular BCB Bank for our main event sponsor. Thank you so much. We really appreciate it. If you don't know who Rotary is, Rotary is a service above self organization. We have five clubs on Staten Island. That's Gateway, Mid Island, North Shore, South Shore, and Staten Island. All meeting at different times. We do great work for the community. If you're interested, reach out to us. Thank you again for being here. We love working with Rolling Thunder on this event and helping our veterans. Thank you.
Thank you, Eric. Thank you very much. Just to do an introduction, as you'll see to my right, there's a picture of a dear friend of mine, Bernard Delray. And speaking for Bernard is his wife, Marguerite. Marguerite?
I remember when Bernard came home one night and told me about a conversation he had with his very dear friend, Rich Savasta. They spoke about whether Rotary, which Bernard was in, and Rolling Thunder, with which Rich Savasta was in, could do a joint event to help veterans in need. Bernard never refused an opportunity to help anyone in need, and also never refused a challenge. all of the other Rotary clubs jumped right in. It was quite an undertaking to organize the five Rotary clubs together with Rolling Thunder to make this event happen for the first time in 2016. But anyone who knew Bernard knows that Bernard took organization to another level. When Bernard was involved in something, he was all in, often pulling in his office staff as well, particularly Anna and Dolores. And when Bernard passed, Christine DeHart and Linda Aubrey stepped up to fill the void. Bernard was very passionate about being a Rotarian and the opportunity it gave him to help other people in need. And he was especially passionate about this event to help veterans. His children and grandchildren are here with me from as far as New Zealand, and we are truly honored and grateful that you have held this event in Bernard's memory. On behalf of him and us, thank you so much.
Thank you, Marguerite. Right now, I would like to introduce to you a man I have a great deal of respect for and admiration. He's been part of the Rolling Thunder family for well over 25 years, if I'm not mistaken. He has done more for veterans than most people ever will. My president, Vincent Perno.
Thank you, Rich, for that introduction. I am Vinnie Perno. I'm the president of Rolling Thunder, which means I am the proudest person here today, representing almost 100 of members over here you see with the vests, just knocking it out of the park. So to them, I thank them very much. We are a veterans organization, support organization. Our primary mission is to promote the POW-MIA issue, to educate the public that almost 90,000 people, prisoner of war, missing in action, never came home. So 90,000, that's the Super Bowl and a half if you're watching it on TV, that's how many people there are. So on behalf of the whole chapter, I want to thank everybody who came out today in support for this. Working with the Rotary Clubs has been phenomenal. Special thanks to Richie Savasta, he says I do all the work, he's incredible. And to Bernard Del Rey and everybody from the Rotary Club, with your help, we helped to the tune of nearly $20,000 last year for veterans. And that's thanks to our sponsors, our vendors, and all you people who come out here and spend your hard-earned money on a fantastic event. All money goes to veterans. I'll ask you to head down the street over here, check out our Wall of Honor. We have a POW chair of remembrance there. You can read that chair, maybe put a little bit of perspective in your day. Tell us about those that never came home. So on behalf of Rolling Thunder Chapter 2, I really like to thank everybody from the Rotary. Thank everybody for coming out and enjoy this wonderful day. Thank you.
Okay, everyone, that's it for the opening ceremony. We try to keep it short and sweet. Again, all I can say is thank you. God love every one of you. Thank you for coming. Thank you for supporting us. Thank you for supporting the Rotary. Have a great day. Enjoy. Eat, drink, and be merry. Take care.
The president of Rolling Thunder, Staten Island chapter, that is, Vinnie Perno joins us right now. It's great to see you again. How are you?
I am great. Always great to see you, my friend, on this beautiful day.
It is a beautiful day indeed. You're everywhere. Rolling Thunder is everywhere. You're here for Oktoberfest. What makes the organization do the things that they do for so many people here on the island?
Well, the simple answer is our membership. We have over 150 members now. I'll say, like I always do when I see you, we are not a motorcycle club, never have been, never will be. We are a veteran support organization. You don't need a motorcycle to belong to our chapter. You don't need to be a veteran. You just need to have a little passion and some free time to help veterans. So the reason that we're out here today is to help veterans. We are, in 2016, we joined with the five Rotary chapters of Staten Island to put on this beautiful event. This is the best year ever here at Richmond Town. We're up, greater, bigger, and better than usual. And the Rotary clubs very graciously donate all the proceeds from this event to our chapter, Rolling Thunder Charities. We put it in a charities account. And from there, we're able to help so many veterans in need. To tune, just from last year, almost $20,000 spent on local veterans that need it. So awesome. It's a great day. They're great people. It's a wonderful experience.
Have you come across any veterans personally? And if so, what has the interaction been like?
I come across veterans all the time. I get phone calls from veterans. Interaction tends to differ.
Sad to say, there are 22 veterans a day that are committing suicide and killing themselves. So as part of our mission statement, we have a 22 patch. I'll show it to you here. You can see that, 22 too many. We raise money for that and working on PTSD and support groups for them. We have equine therapy programs that seem to work great for the veterans, as well as dogs, service dogs and companion dogs. We hooked up with one soldier, one dog, one team, who's Timothy Duffy. Navy veteran, retired fire department gentleman, and he does great things with that. So our interaction is phenomenal. We thank veterans every time we see them. We pass that word along to our youth, our young children, our junior members. So even my kids, if they see somebody with a hat, most of the time it's a Vietnam veteran hat or an Afghanistan, you say, thank you for your service, and it means the world to them. Unfortunately, the Vietnam veterans didn't come home to quite the welcome that the veterans are getting today. So part of our mission is to correct the past and protect any future veterans from ever getting left behind and getting the respect that they deserve.
Tell us more about the POW-MIA issue.
Okay.
That has been quite a discussion that's been had for many, many years. What goes on during those talks, and what resolution does everyone to see happen?
Okay, so everybody knows Rolling Thunder. You see us everywhere helping veterans. Our mission statement, our main function, and the reason we were formed is to educate the public of the POW-MIA issue and tell people that over 90,000 people were missing in action, prisoners of war that never came home. So I'll take a minute. 90,000 people, put that number in perspective. So watch the Super Bowl on TV and add up everybody in the parking lot and throw another 10, 15,000 in it. That's how many people didn't come home. So we also fight in Washington for legislation to help us find these POWs. We have been getting remains back from as far back as World War II lately. We have a lot of things going on with the government that we're always on top of to try and bring awareness and get our people back. It's never too late to bring them home.
I'm really interested to know more about the way you guys reference yourselves. We see you on motorcycles all the time, yet you're not a motorcycle club. What do you like to refer to yourselves as the most?
Okay. We are a veterans support organization. We're not a veterans organization. That would be a VFW or an American Legion, like that. Those are all veterans. I'll say you do not need a motorcycle. You do not need to be a veteran. We have men, women, we have civilians, we have children, we have junior members. You can be a junior member of Rolling Thunder until you're 18, and then you become a full member. So we are not, or never were, or never will be a motorcycle club. We are a veteran support organization comprised of over 150 wonderful people that have free time, give their free time to help and support our veterans.
I spoke to one of your dear friends earlier. He said he was here since 7 a.m. this morning. And this event lasts until dusk. Why donate so much of your free time for this cause?
Well, this is my passion. I have not much free time, but the free time that I do have, I give to veterans. My wife is very understanding. She's also a member, has been for a long time. My children are members. This is what we do. You know, we sacrifice a little bit to come here and set up to make money for veterans. If it was torrential rain and snow, we would still be here doing that. You know, they're out there fighting and sleeping in cold and rain and snow. The least I could do is come here early to set up so people could come here, have a wonderful day, donate, make money for veterans so we can help veterans.
Thank you so much. You do terrific work.
Thank you.
You and the rest of Rolling Thunder do terrific work. Keep up the good work and good luck to you.
I certainly will. It's a pleasure to see you, and thank you very much.
heaven there is no beer. That's why we drink it here. And when we're gone from here, all friends will be drinking all our beer. Oh la 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 la. Oh la 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 la. Heaven, there is no wine, and that's why we drink moonshine. And when we all go blind, our friends will be drinking all our wine. Everybody, la 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 la, la 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 la, la la.
As always, the genres of film and television go hand in hand. And right now, my dear friend Nick, who's from the Staten Island Film Institute, joins us. It's really nice meeting you, Nick. Thanks so much for joining us. How are you today?
I'm doing great, Jamie. We're having a fantastic time here at Oktoberfest. Thank you to Rolling Thunder for putting this on.
Talk to us more about the relationship that you developed with Rolling Thunder. How did it begin?
Sure. So with the Institute here, we're a nonprofit organization designed for anyone that's interested in film. If you want to make movies, you want to appreciate movies, we're here to promote and preserve independent film. And there's actually a film called The Field Afar, a documentary about a Staten Islander, Father Vincent Capodanno. And this November the 9th, we're actually going to be putting on a screening that Rolling Thunder is supporting with us. And it's going to be an incredible tribute to our veterans, as well as an appreciation of a great Staten Island story.
Tell me about the role that you play with the Film Institute.
Sure, so I'm actually the founder and president of it. I'm a native Staten Islander here. And part of what we're trying to do, again, is all year long have networking events, workshops, film screenings, all leading up to October 2020, the International Staten Island Film Festival. A three-day event that's going to bring the best films across the world and Staten Island, celebrities, red carpets, you name it. I'm telling you, it's something Staten Island deserves, and we've needed it for a long time. It's finally coming back.
We have a lot of movie fans that make their way to the cinema daily. Can they expect something different from the Film Institute? And if so, what?
Yeah, definitely. So, you know, we see a lot of Hollywood movies in the theaters. Big budget, let's say a lot of visual effects. You know, let's go back to the core. Independent film, if you've ever binge-watched anything on Netflix, most movies on there are independent. So I think they're better. The stories have more depth to them. And you know what? Maybe you could see a local story that you could see your local neighborhood on screen. And that's what we're trying to do with the Institute and the Staten Island Film Festival. And to learn more about us, it's sifilminstitute.org. We're on Facebook. We're on Instagram. You can get all the information.
Tell me about your own time in the business. How did you get started and what made you decide to go into film?
So I've always been a filmmaker myself, a storyteller. I've made short films, and about a couple of years ago, I did a feature film. I shot it around Staten Island and New Jersey, and then I went out to Los Angeles, and you know, after time coming back, I said that there's a void here, especially in Staten Island. We need a really awesome film festival that will support and promote filmmakers and let the community come out and get involved. It's just a good time thing.
As everyone knows, the film industry is probably the single most difficult business to try and break into. For those who want to live that dream of being a storyteller, such as yourself, what is the first thing that they should do?
You have to network. First off, directing, producing, editing, you have to learn your craft. Secondly, you have to meet the people that are making films. If you want to act, you got to meet directors and producers. That's why a big part of our mission is holding networking events throughout the year. An opportunity to meet with production companies, studios, actors, directors, producers. You have to network. You, at any given moment, you should be able to go into your phone and say, I know somebody that works in any realm of the industry that I can call and say, hey, is there any work I can do? Can I shoot for you? Can I edit for you?
What is the Institute's number one goal?
The number one goal here is to really inspire filmmakers and content creators to create, to preserve and promote their work. And then most importantly, I mean, I'm sure you're a movie lover, I am. We want to appreciate and love movies, local stories, international stories, and just cultivate a community around all forms of filmmaking.
You've been in the business quite a while. Would you have a favorite movie that you can say that you can never get enough of or never be tired of?
So there's a couple of movies, but I always love The Graduate with Dustin Hoffman, directed by Mike Nichols. I think it's a great story. I think it's a simple story. And what I love about it is that in today's age, in 2019, it's not a visually effects crazy story. It goes to show that if you go out there with a camera and you have an important message you want to tell, you can make a blockbuster.
That's really interesting that you mentioned how things have evolved. How do you feel about the constant CG that's being used in movies, and also the fact that the industry seems to be dominated a lot by the comic book genre?
Yeah, you know, it's the big thing about that is I always think that with the industry, you know, they want to make a first movie, a second movie, a third movie. You can do that. You can make sequels and, you know, all different films with that kind of genre. With CG, sometimes they do it because for them it's cheaper, they can outsource the work and not have to film half the movie. But I always say, in the end of the day, as long as you're doing something, whether it's green screen, CG, graphics effects, whatever it is, but it's appropriate to the story, do it. That's what matters. Always treat the story the way it has to be.
Another way that people have been watching their movies is through streaming services. Do you have a preference as to how you would like to see your films, whether it's through streaming services or the more traditional movie theaters?
So in the end of the day, you make a film, what do you want to do? You want it to go into the movie theaters, right? That's why we have the film festival. You make a film, you submit it to us. If it wins, you're going to play in a great venue across Staten Island. Additionally, we have great relationships with companies like Netflix, Amazon, Hulu, that you have the opportunity that someone from that company can see your film, potentially purchase it, and have it online to watch. So in the end of the day, as long as someone's watching your film, whether it's at the movie theater or on Netflix, as long as they're seeing it, you're a filmmaker, you know?
Nick, excellent job.
Thank you, Jamie, I appreciate it so much. Thank you. And again, sifilminstitute.org. Get us on Facebook, get us on Instagram. Submissions for October 2020, the film festival, will be opening soon.
Thank you again, Nick.
Thanks, Jamie. Appreciate it.
4.
Give me a ticket for an airplane. Ain't got time, won't take no fashion. I gotta get back home to my baby's arms again. One of the days are gone, I'm coming home. My baby, she wrote me a letter. She wrote me a letter that she called me without me no more. I got to get back to my baby once more.
York.
There are many organizations here that have a major cause to fight for. One of those causes is organ donation. And right now, my dear friend Christine, who represents Transplant Support Organization of Staten Island, is joining us. It's really nice meeting you, Christine. Thanks so much for joining us. How are you today?
I'm well. How are you?
I'm very well, thank you. For those who may not be familiar, what does Transplant Support Organization do?
So our group was founded about 16 years ago on Staten Island to bring awareness to families who might need to know about organ donation, people who are recipients, people who have donated, and people who need general knowledge. So right now in the United States, there's 13,310 people waiting for organs. And in New York State alone, we have a little over 9,500 people waiting for organ donation. So what we like to do is we hold monthly meetings and try to just bring to the public the urgent awareness to sign up to be an organ donor, because once you're not here, why not pass those organs to someone who can use them?
Your organization is really unique in that it's made up exclusively of volunteers, correct?
Yes, the entire organization is volunteers. It began from people who received organs and needed more information, or as a support group. It originally started just to support, talk about maybe the side effects of the medications after the donations and things of that nature. And then as the group grew, it was not just supporting, now it was bringing awareness, because we see the need for that organ donation, especially in New York. We're the lowest state for organ registries.
Do you or someone in your family know someone that is an organ donor?
My entire family is organ donors right now. My mother was a heart transplant recipient, so she received a heart. My aunt received a double lung transplant. The president of the organization received double lungs and a kidney from his brother. So in the organization, everyone's either received or donated, or through family know someone who has, and that's why the cause is so dear to us.
When you hold your meetings, what is the most talked about topic?
How to bring awareness to New York so that we could get our numbers up on the registry. We're such a huge city with so many diverse people, and there's such a need, we don't understand why we're the lowest enrollment. So it's really like networking. We ran ads in Staten Island Ferry. We try to, you know, show up at as many like local things that there are, just to get the word out there so people understand how important it is. That's really our biggest push.
Here is the question that is probably a really unique subject for anyone in this field. Why should people become organ donors?
So we like to say, if you needed an organ, would you take one? God forbid. Once you're not here anymore, you don't, your body doesn't need those organs anymore. And when you give them to someone else, you give them that opportunity at life to experience more, to see their family, maybe meet their grandchildren, watch their children graduate college. So no one's taking them from you now. After you're not here, what are you going to do with them?
On average, how long does it usually take for someone to wait to get a transplant?
That's really dependent on what you need transplanted and the state you're in. So I don't want to throw out numbers that I'm not 100% sure of, but I'll see. I have a fact sheet right here. In New York right now, we're waiting on 347 hearts, over 1,100 livers, almost 8,000 kidneys, 132 lungs, 168 pancreases, and 11 intestines. Those are people waiting as of 2019 here. Most patients wait 1 to 2 years, but in New York, it's average of 3 to 5, and that's on an average. So it can be quicker, but it can also, unfortunately, take much longer.
I understand that the kidney transplant is probably the most common transplant that takes place here in the state. A good almost 8,000 in New York State alone. What should be the one thing that people should learn about organ donation?
I think it's really important to just talk to your family about it, to make sure that your family's aware of your wishes. And what's unique about kidney transplants is a lot of kidney transplants donors are live donors. So if you know someone, or if you're in a really giving, generous mood, you can get your blood type tested and you can be a living donor. You don't need both of your kidneys. And we have a member in our group who gave her kidney to her son, and they're both alive, they're both well today, because she gave him that gift at life.
This is a great job that you're doing for our neighborhood.
Thank you so much. We really enjoy having you.
Thank you so much for taking time out to speak to us. Continued success and good luck to you.
Thank you very much. Have a great day. Thank you.
What would an Oktoberfest be like without good German dancing? Well, joining us right now are Peter and Paul, and they represent Bayern Verein Newark Incorporated. That was excellent, excellent dancing. Congratulations to you. How are you?
Thank you. Very well. Thank you.
Tell us more about the organization. How did they begin?
Organization was begun in 1930. Founded by German immigrants in Newark, New Jersey, where they wanted to continue their traditions of both Bavarian and Tyrolean culture since they immigrated over from Munich and various other areas of Bavaria and Austria.
How long does it take to prepare for a dance like this?
It can take quite some years to perfect it, but we have newcomers that have come in. And actually, within a month or two, they can actually perform the various dances that we do. Obviously, not to perfection, but we don't push or strive for that in the beginning stages of their learning career.
I see that you do the dances.
It took Pete 60 years to get it right.
Really?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And we still got to work on it a little bit.
I see. I see that you did the dances both as a couple and also... you each performed step type of dances. Can these dances be done both as a couple and individually, or can it be done one or the other?
No, it really needs to be done as a couple. I mean, we march out as a couple, we dance as a couple, even though maybe we separate for a period of time. The Bavarian Schuhplattler, which we perform, is the woman and the man are actually dancing together throughout the entire dance.
How many types of dance are there?
Oh, there are quite a few. There's 40 to 50 different types of dances. It all depends on what club is performing, and each one has their own repertoire of dances. We have at least 20 to 30 different types of dances that we do with our repertoire.
Do each of you have a favorite dance?
Yeah, it's called the Schnackelwalzer. It's one that's a little bit fast-paced, a lot of fun to watch. Involves a bunch of different steps that we normally don't do in more traditional plattlers, but it's a fun one to dance.
And what's your favorite?
Actually, my favorite is also the Schnackelwalzer, but there's another one called the Steirefigurentanz. That's a figure dance that we do. It's a flirtation dance is also quite impressive. Along with that, we do audience participation. That involves the crowd to watch the same.
I've always been curious about what makes a good dance pair. What should they have?
Timing, first and foremost, but also chemistry. They need to work together as a couple, but they both have to be able to hear the music, listen to the music, and be in time with the music.
Is there a hope that the dance troupe has set for themselves for down the road? And if so, what would it be?
That's extremely important to say, because with the club starting in 1930, most of those members have since gone, but we have second generation and third generation continuing on with the culture and providing whatever is possible to keep the club going strong.
One thing that we know about Oktoberfest is that we all like to have a lot of fun and a lot of the bubbly. But what do people have wrong about German culture? What should they know that they've been misinformed about?
Oh,
that's a tough one.
You know, I would say that you need to go to Oktoberfest and experience it yourself, and you'll truly understand what the German culture is all about. And it's summarized in a German word called Gemütlichkeit, which doesn't have a translation into English, but essentially my best translation is that it's enjoying another person's company, enjoying company of just others, and being at peace with the world and enjoying a beer or Brotzeit, which, you know, breaking bread, whatever it might be. It's just enjoyment. It's a tough word to translate into English.
Well said, well said.
What, for all of the German audience out there, or the young generation of Germans that might be watching this, what should they take with them to the outside world about their culture that they should show to everyone else?
Well, like I was saying earlier, with the generations carrying on with the tradition, the next step will be for the next younger generation to fulfill what we have been trying to carry since day one.
Excellent job. Thank you.
No, I would say the same thing. It's really about just continuing the traditions, understanding our heritage, how we contributed to the development of the United States. As I understand it, people of Germanic descent actually are the largest percentage in the United States. So, you know, it's just something to be aware of, be proud of, and continue forth with.
Absolutely. Guys,
thank you.
Excellent
thank
job.
You so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Continued
thank
success.
You.
Good luck to you.
Good luck to you as well.
Thank you.
What would any big event in Staten Island be without the help from our dear friends at Rolling Thunder? That's where Richie comes in. Hi, Richie. How are you?
Good. How are you? It's good.
Good, good. And of course, what would an Oktoberfest on Staten Island be without a mastermind or one of the masterminds? This is our dear friend, Charlie. It's very nice meeting you, sir. How
nice
are you?
Meeting you, too. Thank you.
How did the idea for the Oktoberfest on Staten Island begin?
Well, actually, we decided to do something for veterans first. We decided that it would be a good idea to have an Oktoberfest. And we got together with Rolling Thunder, and they've been so instrumental in helping us. They vet out the veterans for us to make sure that the right veterans get the money. And they've been instrumental in really the whole thing. So between the two, the five Rotary clubs and Rolling Thunder, it's been an amazing partnership.
How long has the Oktoberfest here on the island taken place?
Was it our fourth year now?
Yes, four years.
4 years, and if I'm not mistaken, I think it's the first year we've had it here at Historic Richmond Town, correct?
Yes, it's been a wonderful venue. We're really thankful for Richmond Town to give us this space to use for veterans, and we really appreciate it.
By any chance, would you happen to have any German ancestry in your family?
Zero. I'm 100% Italian.
There you go. Now, aside from helping out the veterans, is there another goal that you set for this event?
No, actually, it's all for veterans. We want to help veterans on Staten Island.
Speaking of the veterans, Rolling Thunder has worked tirelessly to try and help out every single veteran here on Staten Island and abroad as well. What's your state of mind knowing that you've been able to help make a difference for them?
My state of mind, well, as a group, as an organization, we always feel that there's still always more to do. I mean, it's wonderful when we have the help and when we're able to help a veteran in need, whether it be for paying their bills, their mortgage, their rent, their utilities, their medical bills, purchasing mobilized chairs for them, whatever it is we can do, even if it's just an ear to listen to. They're just, because today's veteran, especially today's veteran, many of them are coming back with PTSD. We have an epidemic right now of 22 veterans a day on average committing suicide. This is not something that should be considered acceptable to any American, any American. This is unacceptable. We have to do things to help them to reassimilate to society and to help them know that we care. They're not alone. And we have to be able to help them in any way, shape, form that we can as Americans. We live under the umbrella and comfort that they provide. They provide it for us. They ultimately write a check and on it up to and including their life. Not too many people can do that. And they do it for us. So there's really literally nothing I feel that we there's no limits to what we should be doing for them. Really.
Have you gotten any feedback personally from any veterans that you've interacted with? And if so, what have they said to you?
There's a lot of feedback. I don't know that I feel comfortable repeating what's said to me. I mean, as a group, as an organization that helps veterans, we don't do it for thanks. Yeah, we get it. We get thanks, I guess, and they appreciate us, and we go to their homes. But what we do is not done for recognition or accolades or anything like that. This is something that needs to be done. That's how we feel. And when they say, I mean, all we need to hear is thank you. I mean, that's really, you know, and it motivates us to continue to do what we do. You know, I mean, bottom line, that there's no reason to stop. There really isn't.
If there's a veteran that just so happens to be watching, is there a message that you could send to them of any kind that could probably reassure them of better days ahead?
Well, I can only say this. If you need help, contact us. Rolling Thunder, Chapter 2, New York. We have many veterans in our organization. There's one man that's an unbelievable force. His name is Mike Salsona. He is a Vietnam veteran. He's lost both his legs. He's a playwright. He's been in that movie with Tom Cruise, 4th of July.
Born on the 4th of July.
Yeah. And Mike Salsona is probably one of the best advocates for veterans. He knows the system, he knows to work it, he knows what needs to be done. And all I could say is that there is always hope. Never give up hope. We're here to help. There is help out there. There's other veterans. You're not alone. Never feel alone. We're here for you. You gotta know that. Maybe the government ain't, but we are. Period, end of story. We're here for you. You need help, you come and see us. No questions asked. No thanks required. We're there for you. Come and see us. Contact us. That's it.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for all you've done for Staten Island, and thank you so much for all you've done for the veterans.
My pleasure, really. Thank you. Thank you for taking the time to take care of us. Thank you.
Charlie, great idea.
Thank you.
For all of the people here. Thank you.
Not just me. There's a lot of people behind this. We have 5 Rotary clubs in Rolling Thunder. Between us, there's 300 people that put this together. So it's not one person. It's Rotary, the 5 clubs of Rotary and Rolling Thunder that does this. I can't take credit for it.
Tell me more about the relationship that you have, not just with Rolling Thunder, but with the Rotary Club. What has that been like for you and for everyone involved in this event?
Well, look, Rotary just... The whole key is helping people. That's what we want to do. We want to help the community. We want to help the world. And that's what we do with our time. We try to put money back into the community. There's a lot of business people in it, and we like to give back to the community. So this is just one of the things that we do. We're proud of this. We hope everybody had a good time, and we're just proud to help in any way we can.
Thank you, Charlie.
Thank you.
I'm Jamie Hickson, here to remind you, do all you can to not just support your fellow Staten Islanders, but also to support a veteran. Dankeschön.